Okay, so the first thing we're going to talk about today, and this is really just the theme of everything we want to cover, is just what is the goal of being a parent for you? Like, so when you think about what you want your kids to be, I want you to think about what that is you want them to be. Now, I will say there is the answer that you can write down on paper and tell people, and then there's what you actually do as a parent. Right? You know those two things are very different, right? So I'm on the Gut Busters Challenge. I gave $20 and I think I've lost 5 pounds, right? So there's what I'm trying to do, but then what I'm actually doing. And that's very true when it comes to parenting. Like, you might have lofty aspirations for what you want to be as a parent, but what are you actually doing as a parent? So a good way to figure that out is this first line here. It says, I want my kids to be blank. I want you to think about that. Not so much in what you say, but by what you do. What are you teaching your kids that you want them to be? Or what is your objective as a parent? I want my kids to be blank. Now, we could put a bunch of different things in that area. I'm gonna mention three that I think are really common, but are really bad. Okay, and so I might hit you between the eyes right off the bat, and you might be like, oh, that's me, and that's bad, right? That's okay. That's if you're not bothered, then we're not doing anything. So the first one that I might mention is you might write in that box, I want my kids to be successful. Not some of you be like, dang right, that's what I want them to be. I want them to be successful, right? Go, if you ain't first, you're last, Ricky Bobby. That might be what you might say. Or some of you be like, no, I would never write that down. But by the way you parent, that's what goes in that box. That's what you're teaching your kids. You want them to be successful. We could probably weed through the room and figure out who would write that in the box based on how early you got your child into sports, okay? If you got your kids into sports before kindergarten, you probably could write successful in the box or crazy or whatever. I want my kids to be, no, just kidding. I had one of my pre-kindergartner kids in soccer, so that's one of the things we do. We get in there and we go, hey, I want my kids to be successful. And that's fine, you know, we want our kids to be successful. But I would argue that if you had, like, one big thing that you wanted, and that's what this box represents the goal, the overarching goal that everything else bows down to and everything else surrenders to, success is not what you want to put in that box. Because when you think about it and you play it out, if your kid grows up and they're a successful running back for the Lions, right? And they're the best, right? Well, I guess not the Lions, but somebody good. But they're a good, they're a successful running back, and they're a very successful person, but they're a womanizer or they're a liar or whatever. When you look at that, you're going to go, yeah, they're successful, but you're going to wish they had character. You're going to wish they had some, you're going to wish there was something more there. Or if they work down here at the 7-Eleven until they retire, okay, and they clean up floors and minimum wage jobs, but they're good to people, they're kind to people, they have a relationship with Christ, they have the hope of eternity in their heart, you're going to be content with that. And so right now you might think, man, I want my kids to be successful, 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 but you really don't. Success is a byproduct of something that you want even more. So that might be a thing in there that a lot of us would write in there, but I have to fight that urge all the time. And it's important to fight the urge to make your kids successful. I know that goes against everything everybody else is saying, but fight the urge to think your kids' successfulness is really important. Second one I might put in there that sounds like a good one, that I think is a really bad one, is I want my kids to be happy. Okay, so we do that a lot. Now, here's the problem with that. Of course you want your child to be happy. But the problem is none of us know what happy is. If you think back to some of the biggest regrets of your life, you were pursuing what? Happiness. You were trying to be happy. And so that's why you made some of the biggest mistakes of your life, is because you're like, well, I just want to be happy. And people would tell you, you should be happy, or whatever makes you happy. But the truth is, the real truth is, the more you pursue happiness, the less you actually obtain it, the less you actually get it. And so if you're looking at your kids going, man, I just want you to be happy, and everything revolves around whether or not you can answer the question, are you happy or not, One, they don't even know what happiness is, and you don't even know what happiness is for them. And two, they're just going to be soft, weak millennials. Not to stereotype. If you're a millennial in the room, I apologize. But you know what I mean? Like, the stereotypical millennial situation is just bleh. Like, you know, you don't want that. You don't want your kids constantly pursuing happiness. Third one, and this is kind of Freudian, okay? I'm going to put you on the couch, and I'm gonna talk to you a little bit about your psychology here. This is something that parents do. You might write in that box, I want my kids to be dependent on me. Okay? I know that's terrible, right? It sounds terrible, but that's where a lot of parents go, and you'll watch it happen when moms send their kids off to college, and yet they nag their kids all the time when they go off to college, and they're like, did you do this? Did you do that? Did you? Actually, what they want is they want their kid. They don't like the fact that they see their kid being successful without them. And this might be moms a little bit more than dads, but it might be dads too. You are in a constant process where you're like, and you get hooked on it when you're young. Like, I miss, like, sometimes, like, just sit alone and cry because I miss when my little kids would come home. When I would come home from work and my little kids would be like, Daddy! And they would run up and they would both grab a leg and I would walk in with my little kids around my legs, you know, and it was great. And now I come home and, like, nothing happens. I throw open the door and nothing happens. They look up. Sometimes I'll get one of them to look over and go, oh, hey, Dad. That's what I get. I'm like, oh, it's so touching. And, anyway, we get hooked on this wanting our kids to need us. And really when we start parenting, and some of the worst parenting mistakes I think that happen are when parents get really selfish about that and they use their kids to their own end. And really what they're doing is they're just trying to be their kid's hero no matter what. And that can't be your objective. And really, I don't mean to lay a bunch of conviction on you right away if this is you, but it's probably the most unhealthy, selfish thing you can do as a parent is think about what makes you happy and what makes you feel good as a parent. Because the more you do that, especially when they become teenagers, the more you're going to destroy them because you're completely focused on you and not completely focused on them. So that's just three that are good, may sound good, but are really bad. I'm going to give you one, and then I'm going to base everything else that we do, basically this whole course, on it. Bethany might say this a little bit differently than I, but I tried to get it down to one word. We decided a long time ago that we wanted our kids to be godly. It's like above everything else, before success, before nice, before anything, before kind, before happy. We wanted our kids to be godly. And the reason we put that above everything else is because we believe that if they are godly, then really there's nothing that will ever keep us up at night. Like if my kid's on a plane and he's traveling somewhere to go to visit a college or something like that, and his plane goes down, I'll be happy to go to the funeral and be like, hey, my kid's in heaven now. I mean, it's not that I won't cry, but it'll be okay because he had a relationship with Christ. That's all that really matters for me. I know that no matter whether he works at the 7-Eleven or he's a running back for the Lions, that neither one of those matter as long as he's a godly person. When I look at my daughters especially, that is very challenging to have daughters and envision them one day married to a big, greasy man. Because he'll be big and greasy, I just assume. But anyway, but it's okay because married to a running back, is that what you're saying? Anyway, but it's okay because she will be godly, you know what I mean? So godly becomes before everything else. And I know ultimately the only way to be happy is to find godliness. We don't know what happy is, but if we put our trust in God, we follow after God, we put our faith in him, I can tell you that's the happiest you'll ever be in your life. That doesn't mean it's always easy, but that's what brings us peace and happiness. So I'm going to talk about how to have godly kids for this whole thing. And so here's what's kind of fun. We called it Raising Good Kids because I knew that would probably bring in people. And one of the reasons people always say to me, they'll be like, oh, you've got such good kids. Like, really, I laugh because I know there is no such thing as a good kid. Like, that's what's funny. We titled the class that, but there is no such thing, and I want to prove it to you. So one of your blanks there are no good kids. I want to just assure you that from a biblical perspective. I'm going to hit a couple of different verses, but I want you to know, and this is big, because if you view kids as basically good, who are sometimes just misunderstood, you're going to parent completely different than if you look at your kids and go, "Mom, man, those kids are evil. They are born of hell, and they need it driven or out of them." Like, and that, I'll tell you, that's our perspective, and that's what the Bible tells us, is that children are born with, like, this just, like, evil from the pits of Mordor, evil. So there are no good kids. Real quick, here's what the Bible teaches us. Romans 3:10. For no one is righteous, not even one. Not even that sweet little baby, right? My Nevaeh, she's my youngest. When she was little, I mean, she's got these big old cheeks and these big old eyes, and there's everything just absolutely precious about her. But I watched Josiah, my youngest son, take a toy from her, and she was just, you know, that evil comes out, right? Doesn't matter how cute they are. And it's true. Kids they're selfish and they're evil, and if you get a group of them together in the nursery or the preschool over there, you see it at a young age. And it's not just being young, it's their sinful nature. So on to Psalm 51:5 there, for I was born a sinner. Yes, from the moment my mother conceived me. Your child's evil, and you wondered about that, and I'm just verifying it. It's true. I'll give you one more. Proverbs 22:15. I quote this in my house. I just wander around saying this out loud. Folly is bound up in the heart of a child, but the rod of discipline will drive it far away. Right? So that's kind of my, before I actually threaten a discipline, I'm just like, you know, I just want to remind you, folly is bound up in the heart of a child. So basically those three verses, and we could cite a whole bunch more, but those three verses teach us that our kids are evil and they're stupid. And that's really important. And if you parent from a different perspective, it's going to change. So I'm going to teach you how to parent from the perspective that your kids are evil and stupid. And it's not me saying that. I just want you to know. That's God saying that about your children. So just imagine when you brought that baby into your house that God gave you a card and some flowers. And you opened it up and it said, "Your kid's evil and stupid." God, signed God. Okay, so the next blank in here is God makes people good. There's only one way to be good, and it's not by raising good kids. It's not by teaching kids right from wrong. It's not by drilling things into their head. It's not by disciplining. It's by leading them to Jesus, because only Jesus can make them good. And they're going to make mistakes, and they're going to fail, and they're going to sin. And really, unless your kids, like, mess up, they're never going to know how to not do that. But they've also got to understand what evil is and black and white. And so you lead your kids to Jesus, because only God can make someone good. So here we jump into parent with truth and grace. So I want to stick those two words in your head. It says about Jesus that when he came to the earth, John chapter 1, verse 14, it says, "The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. He came both full of truth and grace." So what made Jesus so unique is it wasn't just truth and it wasn't just grace. It was truth and grace. I think we could divide every parent into a room. We could divide a line in here, and you could probably all find yourself somewhere along it. There's the truth people, and by that it's the disciplinarian. It's the one that doesn't let the kids get away with jack. It's the one that yell sometimes. I mean, you are the law giver. And down on the other end, it's like, "Oh, but they didn't really mean it like that." And you've got the grace person that's all the way down here and is loving. And my favorite scene of the grace person is the lady from the Christmas story, where he thinks he's going to get killed because he lost his glasses. What'd he do? Oh, he got in the fight. He got in the fight and beat the crud out of that one kid, right? So he thought he was going to get in trouble, but mom had grace, right? And that you saw the truth and you saw the grace kind of working at the same time. The truth is, he should have got beat for that, because I'm a truth guy. But anyway, so just here among you, who would say you're more on the truth side of the parenting thing? Yep. Lawgivers. Somebody's hand just got put down. No, honey. Okay. All right. And how many of you are on the grace side? You're the grace people. Okay. Right. I don't necessarily understand you grace people, but I'm... No. It takes both. It takes grace and truth 100%. I had somebody come to me one time. They told me a situation with their kid, and they said, should I give them discipline or should I give them love? I'm like, oh, shoot, give them love. Always give them love. And that should be in the form of a boot to the butt. That's what that be. That is love right there. My dad had cowboy boots, and I just still remember moments. Anyway, so truth and grace, all operating all the way, all the time. So I want to kind of describe what that means. And because the reason why that's really important is because that's how you lead somebody into a relationship with Christ. If I could adopt people that just come in off the street, you know, we're church-run church people, and if I could just adopt somebody, it doesn't matter, 40-year-old guy, hey, you're going to come home and live at my house, I would try to teach him truth and grace. So really what we're doing is just good old-fashioned evangelism. That's what we're trying to do with our kids. I'm trying to give them truth, trying to give them grace. We had several people that come to the church a lot of times, and they don't know what we believe about homosexuality. So they come in and we're like, so what do you believe about homosexuality? And basically the question they're asking is, do you love us or do you hate us? And I always reassure, first off, we absolutely love you. Like, and this is a place for you, and we're so glad you're here. But if you're asking the question, what does the Bible say about it? Well, I'd love to talk about that more, because the Bible's actually really clear on that. And if you have a relationship with Christ, you need to know that repentance for me meant quit looking at porn, quit drinking, quit lying. And for you, a relationship with God's going to mean probably all that stuff. And it's also going to mean having a heterosexual relationship. So that is a conversation that happens with 100% truth. Like, I'm not going to back up on it. I'm not going to pretend like that doesn't exist in Scripture. But I'm going to come with 100% grace, too. And I'm going to love that person. So that's what Jesus was. And that's why we still talk about Jesus 2,000 years later. Because he was full of both. So what does that look like in parenting? I want to cue up on 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2 is one of my favorite verses because truth and grace are captured in both of it. The first part is all truth. John tells the reason he wrote 1 John. He wrote 1 John. He says, my dear children, I write to you so that you will not sin. So John sat down. He wrote a book. It was 5 chapters long, and his whole purpose was that you should not sin. Like, that's his entire purpose of the book. That's what we need to do as parents. We need to make sure that our kids have this intense sense of what sin is. So there's this really kind of harsh side of this, which looks like this. Give clear understanding of right and wrong. So I don't, especially with my little kids, but as the kids get older, sometimes you have a little more conversations. But when the kids are younger, I'm just like, this is very black and this is very white, right? This is wrong. And this is good, and this is bad, and this is, you know, and I just make it absolutely as clear as I can. So give a clear understanding of right and wrong. And then I have on here, I have zero tolerance. Like, and what I mean by that is, like, zero tolerance. Like, I'm probably not as intense as I once was. And Bethany has been given to me because she's a little bit more on the grace side. But, like, when my kid, it doesn't matter if it's their birthday, it doesn't matter if it's Christmas morning, you do not say no to me or Bethany. If you're a child in our house, that is the rule. If you say no to us, right, like, mad that makes us, and discipline comes. That is, and we'll get into forms of discipline and stuff next week, but that is a spanking in our house. Like, you do not disrespect your mom or your dad by saying no to them. And we had a kid on Christmas morning who was acting a little bit pouty about their Christmas present, and they said something, and then it resulted in a no. And right there on Christmas morning, we disciplined our child. And I have just absolutely zero tolerance. Now, that might sound really harsh, but you got to hold on, because that's really, really important. And people that have a tolerance policy and spank or discipline their kids, end up doing it way more because they have a little bit of a flex there. They have they can do it. I can't remember the last time I spanked one of my kids. It's been a really long time. I've threatened it a few times, but it's been a really long time. I can't even remember what it was like to spank my kids because they know there is absolutely no tolerance for any of that. So on the truth side of things, I believe one of the most important things you can do as a parent is to have come up with a clear, black and white, right and wrong, and give absolutely no flex to that so they know what's going to happen every single time. The third thing under truth is give consistent discipline that can be severe. That's my word. Severe. I'm bringing severe back. Justin Timberlake brought sexy back. I think as a parent, we need to bring severe back. Now, what I mean by that is your kids only understand one language. I'm really trying not to bleed into next week because I do want to talk about when to discipline and when to not discipline. Your kids only understand one language, and the Bible let us know what that is. It's the rod. Like, they understand spanking. Now, I'm not talking about, like, yelling and screaming at your kids. Like, don't do that. In fact, people that don't end up physically disciplining their kids end up yelling and screaming at their kids and probably damaging their kids more than if they were to just go ahead and spank their children. So I'm a big advocate of that. In your house, if you've just decided, man, we just do not do that, that's fine. You figure out what severe is in your house and make sure that they understand what you are saying and bring down the rain when they do things in their life and do it consistently every freaking time. Like, that'd be my best piece of advice. When they're young, when they're old, it does not matter. Give it to them every single time. And the reason I say that so strongly is because I've kind of tried to do the nanny thing. What's the super nanny? You remember watching Super Nanny? And I remember people sitting around going, oh, she is so good. Like, are you kidding me? She is terrible. She takes an hour to teach a kid a lesson. They hold them in timeout, and they didn't stay in timeout. And then you got to hold them in timeout. And the kids understand one language. And the Bible says that folly is bound up in the heart of a child, but the rod of discipline will drive it far from them. Okay, so just figure out what severe is. Okay, so now that might all sound harsh, but stick with me. The second part of that, though, because if you only do the first part of that, you will have a psychopath on your hand. I can promise you that. That is how psychopaths are bred. If you're just severe and you're just truth, in fact, some of you might have grown up in a household like that. How many people grew up in a household of just truth? People, right? I grew up in one that was more on the truth side than the gray side. There was grace there, but like it wasn't in October, you know. There were times in my life where I don't remember where grace was at. So there's a lot of truth in my house, and that'll leave you empty. And if you've got teenagers or you've got kids, even if they're just like 9 or 10 years old, and you see a lot of like anger in them, a lot of frustration, a lot of rage. I would bet that you probably got a little bit too much of just the truth going on. Now, that doesn't mean that you pull back on that at all. You keep the truth headed in the right direction. You keep the hammer down on the truth. But what that means is you come along with the grace and you increase the grace because Jesus was both full of grace and truth. So here's what that looks like. The second part of 1 John 2:1 says, my dear children, I write this so you will not sin, but if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. What that means is, John is saying completely, do not sin. But if you do sin, and I can just imagine it pained him to say that, because he's like, the whole reason I wrote this letter is so that you wouldn't sin, and as soon as I write this, you're going to be like, oh, we can sin? Right? You knew that was going to be the response there, and that is what people do. He says, But I want to write this to you so you don't sin. But if you do sin, there is grace that comes from Jesus Christ. So we, on the other hand, have gotten to a place where we really create an atmosphere where there is a bar, there is an expectancy that this is always wrong. And then there's also kind of this understanding that you're going to mess up. You're going to make mistakes. You're going to fail. You're going to sin. That's where my house, growing up, like, that really drove me away from God. is there was an expectancy that there that was great. And I always looked at that, and I'm like, well, I'm not that. So I just went, so I know I'm going to hell, so I might as well live like hell. So I was just, like, completely off the reservation, you know what I mean? I was just as far away from God as I could possibly get. So it's been very important in my life to keep that truth there, but to come back and be like, but we also have a household full of grace. So here's what that looks like in our house. This has been probably the best thing that we've done as parents. Never punish confessed sin. So early on, when the kids are little, if a kid comes to me and says, I broke so-and-so's toy, I'll go like, thanks for telling me. And that's it. That's all there is. And we try to breed that all the way throughout their entire life so that when they're older, to the point where my son can come to me when he's 14 and been like, I kind of looked at porn. And we're like, oh, well, you kind of shouldn't do that anymore, right? You know what I mean? Like they, to the point where their conscience, if a child's conscience gets to them, they need to be able to talk to somebody. And guess what? Their kids' friends at school don't care that they looked at porn. They're like, way to go, dude! What'd she look like? Anyway, you know what I mean? There's nobody on God's green earth that is going to do that. And your kids have to be able to come to you. So we never punish confess sin. And what that means is that sometimes my kids will rush to confess something before I find out about it, which I'm still cool with, right? Unless it was, like, super manipulative, like there's a note in the bag from the teacher, right? And they get home, they're like, oh, by the way, I did this, before you look at my notes from the day, you know, unless it's really stupid like that. But so we've done that, and sometimes it's been very hard for Bethany, and Bethany will just be like, well, what are we going to do to him? And I'm like, nothing, because he confessed it to us. He shared that with us, and we go, wow. Now, here's the beauty about that. That doesn't take away from truth at all. In fact, that is a beautiful act of truth because they are admitting wrong. They're saying, hey, I did something wrong. I don't need to bring the hammer down on them because they've already got that there. Now, on the other hand, if I find out the same exact thing, but they didn't confess that to me, and they're holding on to me, or maybe they're even lying about it, and just, right? If you're covering it up on top of all that, so bring the hammer down on that. So never confess, or never punish confess sin. Transparency of past and present sin. So fun times at our house is me saying, you know, when I was 15, I got drunk and got my underwear and got up on a house and jumped into a snowdrift in front of 50 people, you know. So I just make sure that they know stories like that. And I don't always glorify it, right? Sometimes it's kind of funny. But I don't usually try to glorify it. Usually what I try to do is, like, I want you to know, like, I know what that's like, and I know what the temptation is, and I know what the lead is there. And this is especially hard for Bethany to do because she's a great little church girl and never did anything wrong. Her biggest sin in this world is that she watched Basic Instinct at her friend's house. I don't even think you watched the whole thing, did you? Oh, you did. Oh, she does. She still has guilt about that. And I'm like, that's nice. Sin all the same, I guess. But anyway, but she's transparent about it. And as Megan's gotten older and stuff like that, she's been very transparent about, like, the lure of boys and what that's like and that temptation. And sometimes a boy can go from just a boy to, like, a golden calf that you are bowing down and worshiping, right? And that happens instantaneously. But she's very transparent about that. I'm very transparent with my kids. And that is super important. They need to hear what a complete mess up you are. So that's sometimes difficult for people to do. And you want to do it in waves, right? If you were a prostitute at one point in your life, you don't need to tell your fourth grader that, right? But eventually, you're going to let them know. And you need to let them know that you were a prostitute, but it may not be in the fourth grade. And then finally, create a fail-friendly environment. So constantly have a place where you are just saying, man, can my kid fail? Have I set them up for failure? Can they fail in this environment? If they were doing something wrong right now, could they fail and feel okay doing it? Could they admit that they've failed? Could they feel comfortable failing? Is this a place where they can fail? And that is something that you have to work on constantly, is try to figure out how that is. And sometimes that's just talking with them. Kind of back to the confess then thing, I have actually busted my kids before. I've found out that they've done something wrong. But I have, and this might be a little sneaky, but I've gone to them and I've been like, hey, just woke up praying today and wondered if everything's okay with you. Is everything all right? Is there anything you want to tell me? And finally, I'll get them to tell. I've done this on two different occasions, and I've got them to confess something to me. And you can't tell them this, though, because I still have kids. I'm still in the middle of this. But that they thought, just out of their own conviction, they were telling me, right? They thought the Holy Spirit was working. And it was. It was. But they just thought that was happening. I would so much rather do that than bust them, okay? And the old truth me would have just been like, aha, I got you, busted you. Just the thing you want is for a child to come to you and say, hey, this is how I messed up, blah, blah, blah. So that is truth and grace. I'm going to hit a couple more things. We're going to get to some Proverbs, and then I'll open it up for Q&A. So the one thing I wanted to address as I was thinking about all these scripture verses and stuff like that, I thought somebody might be thinking this, so I want to assure you that this is the right thing to do. So this little line here is, cram religion down their throat. Go ahead and write that. Ram it down there, just. And the reason I say that is because a lot of people, that's kind of the pushback they get, and they're just like, well, it just seems like we're going to cram religion down our throat. I just want them to make their own choice. I want you to really think about that a little bit. Do we do that with anything else? Like, do you ever just go like, they didn't want to go to school today? So I was like, well, I really want you to make your own choice. I'm not going to cram math down your throat. No, we're like, shut up and go to school. Like, that's what we do. Even if you're down here on the grace side, you make them go to school because that's what they need to do. Because why? Because it's important. And it's important to you. Just anything in life. We even make our kids, like, go down a water slide. I mean, I do anyway. If I paid that much to go to Kalahari, you are going down the water slide, and you're going to like it. And if they go down it and they're frowning, I'll be like, well, you need to go again because you need to, I need a woo when you go down it, you know. We'll make them go down water slides. We'll make them learn math. We'll make them do all kinds of stuff. But when one of the teenagers is like, I'm kind of sick today. I don't know if I want to go to church. We're like, oh, okay. Well, we don't want to cram it down their throat. No, you just say, no, this is what we do. This is what we do every single week. And for you, that might mean church and youth group. That might mean you. And not only for us does that mean going to church, but that means serving somewhere. Like, you're going to learn how to not be kind of a selfish, obnoxious little brat. And you're gonna learn how to serve and do things and go over the top. And, like, I loved, like, the thing I was looking forward to the most when we were tearing down this place and doing construction, I was like, man, I'm going to get my kids. I'm going to see my kids sweat. Whoa! So excited about seeing my kids sweat, right? So not only do we say, yeah, you should cram it down their throat, and what I really mean by that is just like you do anything else, right? Anything else that's important, you make them do, especially when they're young, but as they get older, you do. And I want to give you a couple verses for that. Ephesians chapter 6, this is one of two parenting verses in the New Testament. So there's only two parenting verses in the New Testament. This is one of them. It's addressed to fathers. If you're a father in here in the room, I would take note of that. If you're a single mom in the room, just put yourself in that place. But if you're our father, really pay attention. It says, do not provoke your children to anger. Instead, bring them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. So how do you provoke your child to anger? You don't teach them nothing. One of the things that my dad did that probably provoked my anger is mom was over here with this sense of right and wrong and blah, 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 and my dad was just completely inactive. He would take me to church. But that was it. Like, and we would go to church religiously, but that was it. And I got frustrated sometimes, and I was out there living like crazy. Like, I was, like, off the charts, living like crazy. And dad would sometimes discipline me, and sometimes he'd make me stay home, and sometimes I got grounded. But he never once talked to me about anything. And he never instructed me in the Lord, even though we went to church. And that was very frustrating to a young teen boy. And I think maybe some of you in there know what that's like too, because you're out there trying to figure out life, but you're getting no instruction from your father. And so when I say cram religion down your throat, that's not all I'm talking about. At least give them as much instruction in Scripture as they get in school, or as you give them with coaching, or as you give them with anything else in life. Instruct them in the Lord. And I know what that means. Probably the biggest thing, and that's the harsh reality, is you got to get your crap figured out. And that's very difficult, because you're just like, I just wanted to raise good kids, right? It's actually way deeper than that. Like, you've got to, like, whatever your relationship with God is, you got to get that figured out. And then Proverbs 22:6, start children off in the way they should go, and even when they are old, they will not turn from it. I haven't seen that happen yet, but I'm hoping. That's going to happen with my kids, so. But you got to train them in it. Again, just like you would school, just like you would anything else. All right. I can't believe that took 45 minutes, but it did. So now I just want to give you this one little piece here, because every time I start talking like I know what I'm talking about, I'm reminded of this. Only God has wisdom to raise your kid. Only God has wisdom to raise your kid. As much wisdom as you try to gain in your life, classes like this, books you read, seminars you go to, really God is the only one that has to do it. You don't know stuff, and you will never know this stuff. You don't know what they're thinking. You don't know what they're experiencing, and you don't know their future. You don't know what's going to happen in this world. You don't know anything, and God has just complete wisdom. And so there's this passage in James 1:5 that I'm probably is the thing that I would give the most credit to. If anybody ever says, man, you got good kids, this would be the reason why, is James chapter 1, verse 5. It says, if any of you lacks wisdom, so the first step is admitting that you lack wisdom. Okay, so just keep that in mind. The only reason we don't say this prayer is because we really haven't gotten to that point, that on a regular basis. But he says, if you lack wisdom, which we all do, you should ask God, who gives generously, and this is probably the best promise in the Bible, to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you. Okay, so this isn't like every other prayer that you might pray. Like, you might ask God to give you certain things, and God be like, no, I'm not going to give you that. But if you're asking for wisdom, he will give you wisdom. It doesn't matter who you are. Maybe you're still a prostitute. God's going to give you, and you pray for wisdom, God's going to give you wisdom. But just keep in mind, he's probably going to tell you to quit being a prostitute. So if you genuinely are seeking wisdom, God is going to give you wisdom. And I can't tell you how important that is. Bethany and I, many, many times, I can't tell you how many times we've gone to bed, and those of you with teenagers know this feeling of going to the bed and we're like, I think they're going off the rails. I don't know if they're going to come back. I don't even think they believe in God anymore, and they're listening to this person, and she's going to be pregnant in 2 years, right? I mean, there's a bunch of fear that just sweeps over you, and literally you talk it out. That's what we do. We talk it out, we talk it out, we talk it out, and then we get to a place where we don't know, and so we just pray, and we pray together, and we end the same prayer every single time. God, just give us wisdom. And yeah, we pray for a lot of things. We pray for their future spouses, and we pray for them to have the right friends at school, and we pray that God's Spirit would work strong in them and all that kind of stuff. But the biggest prayer we pray is just for God to give us wisdom. And I can't tell you how many times within praying that prayer, within the next day or maybe the 6 days later, within a week, all of a sudden we made a really smart decision as parents. And we had to give credit to that prayer. So, don't look at it like, I hate it when people do this and they're like, well, all we could do is pray. I'm like, well, that's enough. You know, that really is enough. If you're sincerely praying, that is enough. All right, so here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to cover these three parenting proverbs, and then we're going to open it up to Q&A with Bethany. So here we go. Think of your questions while I do these parenting proverbs. Again, these are in no connection to anything else I've said. And these are also not approved by Bethany. I don't think she's seen it. So here we go. If your kids aren't scared of you every once in a while, you're probably doing something wrong. Okay? The reason I say that is not because, not scared in the psychopath way, right? In my household, I've never broken up a door with an axe and been like, here's Johnny, right? I don't mean... I don't mean like that. I just mean, like, I think probably some of you in here that had the best parents are parents that every once in a while you knew what was going to happen if you cross that line, if you said that thing, if you rolled your eyes. So I won't give you an example from my life. I'll give you an example from when I was a kid. When I was a kid, I decided I was going to call my mom the B word for the first time. We were sitting at the breakfast table, and she was getting on to me about something. There was a lot of truth happening right there, and I was just like, you're such a... And I said that under my breath, the breakfast table. Now, again, like I said, my dad was kind of a non-event a lot of times. He was just like, shut up and be good. Don't hurt the TV. That was my dad. But all of a sudden, I don't know how he got over to me. He would have had to have gone all the way around the table, but still to this day, I'm convinced he just sort of flew across the table. And there was this little kind of nook behind me where I sat every day, and he grabbed me by the throat, and he pinned me up against the wall, and he had these teeth. He chewed tobacco like crazy, so he had these horrible, ugly teeth, and he just got down like this. It was a face I've never seen before, and he got right up in my face, and he said, that's my wife you're talking about. And I was like, oh, and I'm like 14 or 15 years old. Like, I'm 260 pounds, you know. I'm just up against the wall and about to wet myself. And I know it's hard to believe, but I never did that again. That was really good. And I know some people would be like, it was abusive, it was the wrong thing to do. It's absolutely everything that I needed at the moment. Now, I'm not saying he didn't light up a cigarette and start burning me or anything like that. It didn't get nuts. There was a couple of times in my life where something like that happened. And there have been times in our marriage where, like, our kids were, there was so much disrespect and so much sass that they needed to be scared. They needed to be scared that something bad was going to happen to them. Now, keep that all in check. I know the old adage is never discipline in your anger, which is good, and especially if you have a hard time keeping it together. I want to be real clear about that. If you do have a hard time controlling your anger, you do need to live in that. But some of the best moments of discipline have been right in the middle of anger. There were moments our kids will never forget. So that's my little proverb there. I know it doesn't answer everything in life. If your kids aren't scared of you once in a while, you're probably doing something wrong. Okay, the next one in there. Take them to the concert, but do not buy them a T-shirt. That's just my own little personal way of saying don't give them everything they want. Like, I took my son to a Toby Mac concert. That's what I was thinking about. He's all excited about Toby Mac. I'm excited that he likes Christian music. I'm excited because Toby Mac does a good concert. We go to it. It was a great concert. After it was all over, everybody rushed to get a T-shirt, and I was like, T-shirts are for suckers. And we just walked out. And it was really good because it left him wanting more. Like, he didn't have the full experience. And there are many times in my life where I don't want my kids to have the full experience. We go to Disney World. We've been to Disney World. That's fantastic. I want them to have the bare minimum, pack the water in the cart, we went to Disney World experience. And I know a lot of parents are on the other side going, we want them to have everything, you know. And I'm like, that's just, to me, I want them to look around and go, we don't have as much and we don't need as much. And why that's really important is, one, I want my kids to walk humbly on the earth. That's the most important thing. I don't want them to have fast passes, even though I want a fast pass. Stand in a line like the blue-collar person you are. I think that's really important. And my kids sometimes get confused that that's because we don't have enough money to do it. And I'm like, no, listen, I could do this. I could buy you the clothes that you wanted. I could go shell out that money right now. I want you to know I have the money, and I do not want to do it for you. Because you're not that important. Anyway, so you keep it. I think that's a really important principle. Make sure that they don't get everything that they want in life. Because what do you do when you get everything that you want in life? You know what I mean? And so on Christmas, and just come up with a budget and stay under it. We're not always great at that one. And then the final one, wherever you draw the battle line, please win. Sometimes we draw the battle line in the wrong area, right? And we're just like, oops, I probably shouldn't have drawn the battle line there. That's okay. Win. It doesn't matter. Maybe it's the wrong spot. Go ahead and win. And make sure you win every single time. So, I mean, when little kids, when you're at Walmart, and the reason this pops in my head is just because when I see this happen at Walmart, I'm like, I'm not going to buy you a cookie. I'm not going to buy you a cookie. I'm not going to buy you a cookie. And then he goes ahead and does the very thing that the parent said, I'm not going to buy you a cookie. And we're like, I'm not going to buy you a cookie. And I'm like, the cookie's already gone. Why are you talking about the cookie? Already crossed the line. Anyway, just draw the line and win and die. Literally, I would die if I picked a line to make sure I won. Anyway, that happens with teenagers. It happens with everything. Don't ever back up off a line. And the reason I think sometimes we feel bad or like, oh, maybe I shouldn't have drawn the line there. Maybe I shouldn't have done there. I can tell you, anywhere you draw the line, they're going to try to cross it. Doesn't matter if you draw it way down there or you draw it way up here. They're going to go right up to the edge of the line, kid or teenager, and they're going to try to cross it. What they need to know from you is that you are going to win, and you're going to win every time.